Now that we've discussed trust, and I'm sure Gajendra ji has answered many of the questions, but if there are any left, we take them up in the evening session, in the evening discussion. Now we'll come to the next feeling in the harmony in the family discussion, which is respect. So just to give that brief background, that we are for working for right understanding, and the right understanding means understanding the harmony. We looked at harmony in the human being. Now we are discussing harmony in the family. And in the morning session, we discussed trust. And now we will look at the next one, the next feeling, which is respect. So what is this term respect? What does respect mean actually? That's what we are going to look at. And what we are saying is that respect is the right evaluation. So what we are saying is that when we are rightly evaluated, we feel respected. When we are not rightly evaluated, we feel disrespected. So normally today, you know, what do we use the term respect for? We do all kinds of things in order to, you know, get respect. So whether it be, you know, today's, you know, how we look at respect is like, if you have a big car, then do we call it respect? Is it that you have a big house, then you are respected? Or is it that you have, at your workplace, there is a security guard that salutes to you? Is that what is respect? So these days, there are lots of different people have different thoughts about respect. So here we are saying respect is right evaluation. And in Hindi, if you see, it means samman. Respect is samman. And if you break that up, it is sam plus man or samyak mapna. Theek theek ankalan karna. Which translates to rightly evaluating. So like we said, when we are rightly evaluated, we feel respected. When we are not rightly evaluated, we feel disrespected. But what are we doing today? Instead of rightly we are evaluating, we are either over-evaluating, which means we are evaluating for more than what we are, or we are under-evaluating, meaning evaluating for less than what we are, or we are otherwise evaluating. That means evaluating for something other than what we are. So we'll take some examples so that I can clarify this to you. So when we say over-evaluation, so to evaluate for more than what we are. So if you look at, you know, when people are newly married, they tend to over-evaluate that relationship between each other, between the husband and wife or each spouse, you know. So if the husband brings a gift for the wife feels, oh, he's the best husband in the world. So now that's like an over-evaluation, right? Best husband in the world, we really don't know, we can't say, but you know, she will feel like that. Or if the wife, you know, because they are newly married, the husband might think, oh, she is so good looking, I have the very most beautiful wife in the whole world. So again, this is like over evaluation. Now if you look at that couple, maybe 15 years down the road, you know, they've been married 15 years, now what happens? Now, even the same things that they used to appreciate in each other, now they don't appreciate. Now they start under-evaluating. So if the husband forgets the anniversary one time, the wife starts getting upset and saying, you know, you are good for nothing. You never remember anything. You are useless, like that. Or if the wife, you know, one day she's been cooking every day, but one day there is little less salt in the food and the husband gets very angry and says, you know, you can't cook at all. You are useless. You are no good. So like that. So we tend to keep over-evaluating and under-evaluating. And what is otherwise evaluation? Otherwise evaluation, like, you know, you say you have a child who one day got a trophy at the school. He did very well and he got a trophy. Now you over-evaluated and you said, oh, he he's doing so well. He's the best student in the whole school, not only school, I will say country, even in the world. Like that, we might over-evaluate. Then after a month or so, when he's not doing so well academically or some problem is there, then you start under-evaluating. Are you can't do anything right. You're useless. You're no good. Like that. And then if he still doesn't, if we tell him to do something and he doesn't do it, or, you know, he's not able to do what we are asking him to do, some small job that we tell him, then we even otherwise evaluate sometimes. We'll say, ye to gadha hai, like he's a donkey, he can't do anything. Now we have not even given him the privilege of being a human being. We are evaluating him to be something less than a human being. If you look today, the commonest example of evaluating otherwise is to evaluate ourselves and others as being the body. So we are not aware that we as human beings are a coexistence of self and body. So when we otherwise evaluate ourselves as body, we also otherwise evaluate others as body. Similarly, we will see that when we over-evaluate ourselves, we tend to under-evaluate other people. Or when we under-evaluate ourselves, we tend to over-evaluate other people. Somebody needs to move the mic, I think. So these were some examples of over, under, and otherwise evaluation that we keep doing today. And whenever we do these over, under, or otherwise evaluation, this is disrespect. So that's what we are saying. Whenever this evaluation is not right, this is disrespect. So now we'll ask your opinion about this. Check for yourself. Does this happen with you? Over, under, or otherwise evaluation? Does it happen with you? Yes or no? Do you feel that sometimes, you know, we do this in our behaviors with other people? Do we sometimes over-evaluate others or under-evaluate or otherwise evaluate other people in our relationships? Does it happen? And then you can ask yourself if you think that this is respect or disrespect. So I can see that, you know, this is seems to be very clear to most people that this does happen. Yeah. So almost everybody can see that this does happen, this over, under, or otherwise evaluation. It keeps happening. So you have to check. In every interaction that you have with other human beings, you need to check whether we are doing, you know, whether we are doing it understanding respect, or are we disrespecting? That is, are we evaluating rightly, or are we over, under, or otherwise evaluating? So what's the problem if you over, under, or otherwise evaluate? The problem is that now your reference is outside, and I'll explain what that means. So supposing, you know, if you look at under or otherwise evaluation, and if you look at over evaluation. Now supposing I'm invited to a party and I feel like it's a special party, so I must wear a very special dress. So I go out and I buy this very exotic, very beautiful, expensive kind of dress, which has got all kinds of, you know, sequins, mirrors, and all that, all kinds of things. And I go and buy this beautiful dress and I wear it to the party. Now, when I walk into the party, I'm looking for everybody, you know, whether they are looking at my dress or not. And one person comes up, somebody who knows me comes up to me and says that, oh, you know, you're wearing this beautiful dress. It's looking so good. Now what happens? Now I start over-evaluating myself. I start feeling very good and I start going into ego. I feel, oh, this really is very good. I should wear this. I'm thinking already in my mind that I should wear it to more parties and see how much impact it has. People think it's good for me and I look good in this. So now here, my what is going on in my imagination is in response to what the other person is thinking. So the other person is my reference or what the other person is saying. So here, my behavior is getting decided. I'm thinking of deciding my behavior based on what the other person says to me. So the other person is my reference. I am no longer my reference. I am looking outside. So I am depending on what the other person says to me. And you will say this, you will see this, you know, very often in students who wear those kind of jeans, you know, where they have like a tear or they are faded or something. They almost look like they are torn or they are old jeans. But if you see sometimes, you know, in the market, new jeans are also like this, torn, faded. And you would think, who will want to buy these? But because one person feels that this is the right thing to wear and is able to influence other people, everybody starts following that and, you know, starts wearing those kind of jeans. So here, you know, the other person is my reference. I am not deciding what I need to wear. The other person is deciding. Similarly, if we look at under or otherwise evaluation, now supposing with that same dress in that same party, one person has talked to me this way. I go further and I meet some other people and one lady I know comes up to me and says, my God, I can't believe you're wearing this dress. You know, this went out of fashion 5 years back. I can't imagine you're still wearing this. Now what happens? Now suddenly all that bubble that I had blown up, I had, you know, become so, my ego had become so big. Now that bubble gets burst. Now I'm feeling depressed. I'm thinking, oh no, why did I buy this? So much money I've wasted in this. I wish I had not bought it. And I start deciding to myself, next time onwards, I will never ever wear this dress again. It's a waste now. I've just ruined my money. So now here, my mood again is decided by somebody else. The other is my reference. And my behavior is going to be indefinite. Because when somebody says it looks good, I want to wear it again. When somebody says it looks bad, I don't want to wear it ever again. So here, my conduct is very indefinite. But on the other hand, when I'm rightly evaluating, then I have self-confidence and I become my own reference, in which case I have definite conduct. So if I feel that I should wear what I am comfortable with and I think it is summer, so I feel, okay, I will wear something that is loose cotton clothes. I should be comfortable and I am not so worked up about what somebody else tells me. Now I am making my choice based on what I am comfortable with. And that leads to a definite conduct. Now somebody else is not deciding my behavior. I am deciding my behavior. So it becomes definite. And I have self-confidence. I am neither going into ego nor I'm going into depression. So if you see this graph, you know, which is in line drawing, you know, down below. So instead of being at baseline, we keep going into ego. Our mood swings, you know, up and down. So when the mood swing is up, we are going into ego. When the mood swing is down, we are going into depression. And this keeps happening. And you can, you know, see for yourself if that happens for you also sometimes. So whenever there is under or otherwise evaluation or over evaluation, whenever we are not our own reference, whenever we are not working with our natural acceptance, then we are going by some assumption. And whenever we are going by some assumption, there is possibility of disharmony within. Because only when my imagination is aligned with my natural acceptance, am I in harmony. So when I am dealing with assumptions, there is disharmony, then this institutions. Do we know where it is stemming from? Where is it coming from? So we'll take your reflection on this. In general, I mostly do right evaluation, or I mostly do over, under, or otherwise evaluation. Answer these thoughtfully with sincerity, because these are going to help in your own self-exploration. There's no right or wrong answer here. We are just trying to explore so that we can improve ourselves. So what do we mostly do? Right evaluation, or over, under, or otherwise evaluation? We'll see your reflection on that. You know, there was this student, there was a girl who was doing B Pharma, and she was having some problems. Like, she felt that she's not very beautiful and she doesn't have friends. So when it was discussed further and it was tried to, find out what happened, initially she didn't come out with it, but then she was able to open up, and she said that there were two sisters and one brother, and she was the first one in her family who had studied so much. She had just entered, she was had cleared the exam and was going to start B Pharma. So the parents were very happy with her. So they tended to over evaluate and say, oh, she's the shining star in our family. She's the most accomplished. She has achieved so much and she's so good in her studies and so on. So whenever somebody came to the house, they would ask her to come to the drawing room, sit and meet them, and they would introduce her and all. And her older sister was not so good in her studies. And the older sister, if she even came inside, they would just tell her, you go and make tea for everybody. So now, how do you think the two sisters, the relationship between the two will be? One is being over-evaluated so much, the other one is being almost shunned that you just go make tea. And then she had a smaller brother also who was not doing at all well in school. So he was just being told, that he is just useless. He is the donkey in our house. So he was being otherwise evaluated. Now, this girl who was so much over-evaluated, she started feeling that, yes, I am special. I am very good. These other two are just no good. And she started bossing over the other two children. So when she started bossing over the other two, her brother and sister, the brother and sister got upset and they went and complained to the parents. Now the parents got angry with this girl and they shouted at her and they told her, you better behave, and all sorts of things they told her. And suddenly, there was animosity already in the family between her brother, sister and her, because she was dominating. They were not willing to accept this domination. So there was already some sort of break in relationship between her and her brother, sister. So they were not at all friendly with her. And because she came out and wouldn't talk to others and was aloof and staying by herself, started feeling depressed. She didn't have friends at the college also. So here, a child who, for no fault of hers, has gone into ego first, then goes into depression. Now, if those sort of problems are not cleared, then what's going to happen? Depression is commonly going to happen, and some cases even suicides can happen. So, we can keep awareness of, especially since we deal with students, and we can keep an open mind of what's going on. People come from different backgrounds, different setup. Yeah, so most people feel that they are rightly evaluating. good, but many also feel that they are otherwise under over other under or otherwise evaluating. And you know, that's a very good sincere sort of self-exploration, and that will help us to see what we can do. So now, what do you think? Should the right evaluation be on the basis of the self or on the basis of the body? What is your view on this? What is your reflection on this? Should this right evaluation be on the basis of the self, or should it be on the basis of body? Can we have that evaluation, please? Self or body? So we might be seeing all such examples pretty much every day in our lives. But, you know, are we looking at these closely? Are we evaluating every time, you know? Am I making the right evaluation? Am I treating others with respect, or am I treating them with disrespect? Even over-evaluation is disrespect, because you can ask yourself, when somebody over-evaluates you, when somebody says, oh, you are the very best in the world, how do you feel? Do you feel comfortable inside, or do you feel uncomfortable inside? So if you're feeling uncomfortable inside, that means it's not naturally acceptable to you. And if it's not naturally acceptable to you, it's not the right evaluation. Yeah, so pretty much 100% are able to see that right evaluation should be on the basis of the self. That's pretty good. Nice. So let's look at what we mean by respect. So if we look on the basis of the self, if we look at this evaluation on the basis of the self, then if we talk of our purpose, we already said that we want to live with continuous happiness and prosperity. And the other also wants to live with continuous happiness and prosperity. So our purpose is the same. On the basis of our natural acceptance, we also want to live with continuous happiness and prosperity. The other also wants to live with continuous happiness and prosperity. Our purpose is the same. If we look at our program, my program is to understand and to live in harmony at all the four levels. That is, what is my plan of action for achieving this happiness and prosperity? It is to understand the harmony and to live in harmony at all the four levels. And the program of the other is also the same, to understand and to live in harmony at all the four levels. That means at the level of the human being, at the level of the family. Self has the same program to ensure happiness and prosperity in continuity. Yes or no? Can I see this? That every self has the same program. The program of understanding the harmony at all the four levels. So, am I able to see that every self has this same program to ensure that there is happiness and prosperity in continuity? Am I able to see that? Yes or no, I am not able to see that. If there's any question so far, we can take it on respect. It's early though, we haven't covered that much, but if anybody has...
Nisar Ahmed is there, he wants to say something.
Yes, please. Any question on respect, sir?
Dr. Gyan Murthy?
Yeah, good afternoon, sir. But our mind always asks the respect to others. What is the necessity of this one? It is, I always expecting the respect to others. What is the reason, madam?
Yeah, so if you ask yourself, what is naturally acceptable to you? Do you want to have, like, you know, you can ask yourself, do I want to have this feeling of respect from others? Like, do I want others to treat me with respect? That is one question you can ask, your natural acceptance, and see what answer you get. The other question you can ask yourself is, do I want to treat others with respect? Yes or no? And that whatever answer you get from yourself, that is your natural acceptance. So if you are, you know, if you're getting that answer, yes, I want to treat others with respect. Yes, I want others to treat me with respect. Then that's your answer. That's, you know, that
is mutual only.
Comfort. Yeah.
Sometimes the mutual is good, I think, but our own, my self, but mm-hmm. we are expecting others. But what is the reason? That's why I'm asking.
Yeah, so we keep expecting things like in life, right? We do yeah. expect, but then is our expectation based on the right understanding or not? That we have to see. So if it is based on our natural acceptance, then it is right for us. So like yeah. how I want to treat others with respect. I okay. also would like others to treat me with respect. So in that sense, that expectation is okay.
Okay.
Yeah?
Okay, madam. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, so if we look at the results of this reflection, large number of percentage of people are able to see that every self has the same program for happiness and prosperity in continuity. Some of us have some doubt. So we'll keep exploring. We'll keep seeing. You know, if we look at our potential, we said our purpose and program is the same. If we look at our potential, now I have natural acceptance in me and I have desires, thoughts, and expectations going on continuously in me. Similarly, the other person also has this faculty of natural acceptance. The other person also has desires, thoughts, and expectations going on continuously in them. So in that sense, our potential is the same. So our purpose is the same, our program is the same, and our potential is the same. What do you feel? I can see that every self has the same potential to understand harmony and live in harmony. Yes or no? So here the potential we are talking about is that we have natural acceptance. We have desires, thoughts, expectations, this imagination going on continuously. The other person also has natural acceptance, this faculty, this capacity for natural acceptance. And the other person also has an imagination that is going on continuously in them. So in that sense, are you able to see that our potential is the same? That every self has the same potential? Yes or no? Maybe we can take one more question.
Dr. Menka had raised her hand. Dr. Menka.
Hello.
Yes, please. Go ahead.
Ma'am, can you hear me?
Yes, yes. I can hear
yeah,
you.
Yeah, I'm Dr. Menka speaking.
Yeah.
Ma'am, when you say this potential is the same, mm-hmm. Potential is the same, but mm-hmm. the performance may be different, isn't it?
Yeah, so that has to do with our ability.
Okay, depending on their mood, their background.
It will depend on, yeah, meaning what kind of assumptions they have, what kind of preconditioning they have.
Yes, yes. So,
whether their desires are in line with their understanding.
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
Yeah.
So, based on the situation only, they will give their performance. That is what I feel.
Well, based on whatever their level of
ma'am, for example, today I'm happy.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I will be using all my potential in order to achieve whatever I want today. And mm-hmm. tomorrow I may be in a state of sobriety. So there I don't feel like doing anything. So my potential is suppressed there. And because of that, there is no performance at all.
Now, here when we are saying potential, we are saying your natural acceptance. So it is there continuously in all of us, right?
Okay, okay.
So it is there. We may not have realized that potential.
Okay, ma'am. Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, we all have that natural acceptance. We all have those desires, thoughts, expectations going on continuously in us. So in that sense, our potential is the same. Okay. But we may not realize this potential. We may not align this, our imagination with our natural acceptance. And in that sense, we may not behave with the definite conduct. So our expression on the outside, the behavior might be different.
Okay. Yeah? Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. I think maybe we can take one more question.
Yeah, Dr. Radhakrishnan is there. Dr. Radhakrishnan, you want to say something? Okay, fine, Didi.
Okay, we'll go ahead. So on the reflections also, majority are able to see this. That
in fact, I got reminded of one thing regarding potential, if I can share this here.
Yes, please.
In fact, at Kanpur, there was one student doing BTech at IIT Kanpur, and he was in computer science, and he was not doing so well in academics. So in the first semester, he got a grade below 5, and in the second semester, again below 5, and he was put on academic probation. Mm-hmm. So in the third semester, he came and attended a workshop, and he attended it sincerely, but after that we could not meet him. So we thought that he just attended and got lost, you know, maybe whether he has been able to grasp what has been discussed or not, we are not sure. Mm. Then he came in the fourth semester and shared one thing, that when his performance was not good, he used to get depressed, and in that state of depression, he used to do two things: watch movies or play video games. And there is a video game called Counter-Strike, and this is something very prevalent in the campuses. You know? And 8 students play the game together. Now there are so many other games which are being played. Mm-hmm. And he used to waste his time like this. But after attending the workshop, when he got assured of his potential, then he saw that only his performance is poor, potentially he's sound. Then he started focusing on academics, and then he stopped wasting his time, you know, otherwise. Mm-hmm. And in the third semester, his grade point was 7.6. And in the fourth semester, his grade point was 9.2. Wow. So that way, he shared. And in fact, in the fifth semester, his father expired. So again, there was some setback, and he could not do so well. But when he came out of the campus after getting his degree, his grade point was something around 8. You know? And he got a good job also, probably with Reliance, and he worked in Delhi. And then after some time, he made up his mind that he will not do this job, and he will try to invest himself full time for pursuing this program of value education. And then the company in which he was working, the boss there told him that no, we'll not spare you like this. You have to prepare equally competent people like you, 3 or 4. And you can see such a shift took place in his performance, because he could see that potentially he's sound. And in fact, if all the students are able to see this, all of us are able to see this, then we can transform our lives. By being assured of the purpose, program, and potential. Yeah, this is what I wanted to mention.
Very nice. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. So we already mentioned this. Yeah. We saw that most people are able to see that our potential to understand harmony and live in harmony is the same in all of us. So our purpose is the same. Our program is the same. Our potential is the same. So the other is similar to me, we can say that. So this is the minimum content of respect, that on the basis of our purpose, our program, and potential, the other is similar to me. So do we use that, you know, when we are interacting with others? Are we really having this respect? Are we seeing others as similar to us? So these were the similarities at the level of the self. But in living, what are we doing? Are we trying to accept the other as being similar? Or are we trying to show that we are different from the other? What do you feel about this? In living, do I generally accept the other as being similar to me? Or am I trying to show that I am different from the other? What do we normally do? What do we generally do when we are in our living? It's like this happens quite frequently, you know, when we are
and
living.
Here we can reflect in our relation with the mate, with the
watchman, exactly. The mate, you know? Exactly. Yeah, like are we trying to show that we are different? We, you know, behave differently with different people. Sometimes even when, you know, the children, you know, our children, when they try to play with the maid's children, do we encourage them or do we say, no, not to play with them? You play with other children in the colony. Don't play with the maid's children. So like that, are we trying to show that we are different from the other? Or are we trying to show that we are similar to the others? Do we accept the others being similar to us? The more we keep exploring into this, the more we'll find, you know, that there can be room for improvement and...
Yeah, Didi, I think we can take one question. Dr. Pawai, she has not asked since morning, so we can take one question from her. Dr. Pawai.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. But nowadays, we feel that we should be unique. So you should have something different from others. Only then you can excel in the life. Like that only we are going ahead, no?
Yeah. Actually, we need to see that when we are trying to show that we are different, are we really getting respect from the others or is it more like jealousy? Or are we just getting attention for a brief moment? And then
attention seeking.
Yeah. So is that really respect? Like, you know, a lot of people feel like that, you know, the boss who sits in the office feels that it is his right that the other person should respect. So he says, you know, when I ask for water, the PN sitting outside must bring water. But you ask that PN, that do you really respect your boss? What will he say? He will say, look at him. He can't even get up and take a glass of water by himself. So, you know, we have to see whether we are really getting respect from whatever behaviors we are trying to do on the outside. And we can ask our natural acceptance and see what is really naturally acceptable to us. Yeah?
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. So, yeah, majority say that in living, we generally accept the other as similar to us. That's what we need. That's very good if that is happening. That's nice. But if you look largely outside today, what is happening? We are constantly differentiating. We are constantly trying to show ourselves as being different from the other. We are not looking at our similarities. We are looking at our differences. And the biggest differentiation, which is most obvious, is at the level of the body. Because we think we are the body, every body that is a little bit different looking, we differentiate. So if we might differentiate on the basis of age. So, you know, we say respect elders. So, yes, it's good to respect elders. But what about people, what about children who are younger than us? Are they supposed to not be respected or, you know, do they not deserve respect? So if you have, you know, like a small child in the house, you will notice that, you know, whenever any visitors come, the child will try to, even if you tell the child to go inside, the child will try to come with the toys, will come with the books, will come and sit wherever you and the guest is sitting in the drawing room and will try to open up the books in front of the guests and try to see things and just be there, trying to get attention from the others. The child also needs their respect. The child also wants to be introduced to the other. Similarly, you know, if you have an elder person in the house, you'll find when guests come, the same sort of behavior you can see with the elders also. The elder person, older person might come and sit in the drawing room quietly, might keep looking. Then if nobody talks to them, then they might just hang around in the drawing room. They might try to, you know, adjust something in the drawing room, correct some showpiece that is kept, change its position, do something in order to gain some attention. But we constantly want respect at every age, not just the elders. Similarly, we differentiate on the basis of gender. So we treat men a different way and we treat women a different way. So, you know, you have in certain societies, in certain villages, in certain areas, you know, even in India, there is this preconditioning or this custom that the man of the house will eat first. So the man comes and the woman cooks and gives the man. And after he finishes eating, he leaves his plate unwashed and the woman puts her food in the same plate and eats from that plate. Now, you know, why do we need to do all this? So, and do we think that this is naturally acceptable to the other person when we are making this differentiation? Is it really acceptable to the other person? Similarly, we differentiate on the basis of race. We treat people with a white skin differently. We treat people with a dark skin differently. So when a foreigner from the US or from Europe or somebody who has white skin comes, we talk to them differently, we behave differently with them. But when a foreigner who is from Africa or, you know, Ethiopia or someplace like that, he comes, he or she comes, we might be behaving differently. So are we doing that? Are we differentiating on the basis of race? And we can see, you know, this cream, Fair and Lovely, it has really invaded the marketplace. So much of this Fair and Lovely cream. Nowadays, you even have something like a cream for men, Fair and Handsome. So we have to see what all preconditionings we have and what all we are, you know, we are differentiating on the basis of body based on just what we look like. Similarly, we also have differentiation on the basis of physical strength. So somebody who is strong, we treat them differently. We treat them with more respect. Somebody who is weaker, we don't treat them with as much respect. So what do you feel about this? We'll have this reflection. Can we have this reflection? Yeah. What do you generally do? Do you propose to the child in the family? Do you ask the child? Or do you impose on the child in the family? Or you tell them what to do? This reminds me of incident when I was growing up and my sister, who is some 6 years younger to me, that time she was small. We were both in school that time. She was maybe hardly 4 or 5 years old. And my father was asking something about, you know, at the dining table, do you want to eat this? He was asking everybody, but he didn't ask my sister. So he asked, like, for instance, he asked me, he asked my brother, he asked my mother, do you want this or shall I finish it or something like that? And we said, no, you can finish. But he didn't ask my sister. She was 4 years old that time. So then she was very offended. She said, you didn't ask me. So he said, okay, do you want some? Then she said, no. So he said, he started laughing. Then he said, so if you didn't want it, what was the big deal? If I didn't ask, then she says, I may not want, but you must ask me. You asked everybody else. Why didn't you ask me? So you see, even small children, they don't want to be imposed on. They don't want to be taken for granted. So what do you normally do in your home? Do you propose to the child or do you impose on the child? So the majority are saying that we generally propose to the child. That's good. So here the problem is that this misunderstanding we have that the human being is the body. We don't see the human being as self and body. So that's where the problem lies, and that's why we keep differentiating. And this creates so much problem. So it creates, you know, gender bias and problems with, like you have women's lib movement and for the races, problems with the anti-racial movement and so on. Like we've heard of Nelson Mandela, we've heard of Martin Luther King, all these people who were involved in so many such movements because of this differentiation that we are constantly doing in society. We also differentiate on the basis of physical facility. So on the basis of wealth or on the basis of post. So, you know, if a wealthy person is there, if a person is dressed up very well, we treat them a certain way, we respect them. When a person is poorly dressed, we treat them very differently. When a person is dressed in suit and all that, we might call him sir, or, you know, if it's a lady, we might call ma'am. And if it's just a person who is dressed in a simple dhoti and all, we might just say, are, idhar aao, like that, you know, without any respect. So we treat people who appear to be having more physical facility with more respect, and we appear to treat people who have less physical facility with less respect. Similarly, if we look at the post, we tend to treat people on a higher post with more respect. We tend to treat people who are at a lower post, lower than us, with less respect. So what is your reflection on this one? Do we treat the subordinate, the sweeper, the guard, the housekeeper with respect? Generally, yes, or generally, no? What do we generally do? How do we generally behave? How do we normally treat? So this is not what we would like to do, but how we are in our day-to-day living every day. Are we treating all these people with respect, or are we not generally treating with respect? That is an important question, because it pertains to our day-to-day living, and it has to do with the people that we interact with every day. So the expression of respect may be different, but what is our feeling towards the people? Do we have the same feeling of respect for our boss as we have for the sweeper or the guard or the housekeeper that works for us, or not? That is the question. Can we take a question while this is going on?
Yeah, Didi, I think we can.
Yeah.
So let me ask somebody who has not responded so far. So Dr. Tamil Selvam. Dr. Sillamal. Dr. Radhakrishnan. Okay, you have been unmuted. Dr. Sudha. Probably we are not audible to this.
Oh.
Dr. Sillamal.
Are you able to hear me?
Oh, somebody is online.
Yeah, yeah. Please.
Hello. Can you hear me, sir?
Hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir. This is Sillamal. Yes,
sir. Please, you have a question?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Go ahead.
We are giving respect to them, but they are not responding properly because of the jealous or some other thing. How can we manage that kind of a scenario, ma'am? That's my question.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah, we'll come to it in a little bit as we go further.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll just come to it in a little bit. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Dr. Radhakrishnan. Fine, Didi. I think we can proceed.
Yeah. Okay. So, yeah, majority people are... that, or at least they say that they treat the people with respect, which is good. But if we are not also doing, it is good to explore and see, you know, where we can change this.
One of the exploration could be, would they love to have the lunch on the same dining table together with them?
Yes. True. Very true. So here, the gross misunderstanding is that physical facility is what is going to give us happiness. So, but the real, you know, the reality is that happiness is to be in a state of harmony. So similarly, differentiation we can also do on the basis of beliefs, you know, all kinds of isms, sects, all info. And I'll just explain that. Isms meaning like, you know, we have broken down society into capitalism, communism, socialism. So those who are belong to this group, socialism group, we treat differently. If we are part of the consumer, the capitalist group, we have respect only for those, and so on. Similarly, we have broken down into various sects, various sects, based on whatever belief we might have. So if people belong to the same sect as me, I treat them with respect. When they don't belong to the same sect as me, I treat them differently, and so on. Similarly, we have broken them down into information sects, like in, you know, related to information. Like, for example, if I am a doctor, I treat other doctors with respect, but I don't treat non-doctors with respect. Or if you are an engineer, you treat other engineers with respect, but you don't treat doctors with respect, and so on. So we've broken up society into a lot of these groups. What do you feel about this? How do you generally treat a person of other belief system? Do you generally differentiate? Or do you generally treat a person of a different belief system the same as you? What do you normally do? We'll take up one or two more questions. If somebody has a question.
I think Dr. Muthukumaran. Dr. Karthikeyan.
Yes, good afternoon. This is Karthikeyan.
Yeah, good afternoon.
I have no difference of opinion of giving respect to of their cadre. If a person working under me should be given respect. At the same time, what is my expectation? Everyone should do their work appropriately. Mm-hmm. Sometimes if they fail over there, we are somewhat lacking respect. You know, that we have a feel, you know, we have not given the right treatment to the people. What kind of approach is we are going to take once we have such a feel like that?
Yeah, so we'll be coming to that, but I'll just briefly mention that, you know, it's not that we don't, it's not like at the workplace we just let things loose and we don't have people obey the rules of the, you know, institution or whatever. So we are not saying that, but how is our feeling towards the other person? That is important. We will still have them follow the rules and we will still expect them to do their work and so on. But what is our feeling towards them? That is the important part. But we'll come to that in the next, as we go further, we'll see what one can do about these things. Yeah?
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Dr. Tamil Selvam. Dr. Tamil Selvam, there is some issue, I think, because people are not able to unmute and ask the question. They are raising hands.
Oh.
And if I lower their hand, they again raise the hand.
Hello, can you hear me? Sir. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Madam, with respect to cadre, you are giving respect or treating differently. But I heard that in other developed countries, USA, Australia, mm-hmm. even lower cadre people also respected very nicely. But is it not so in India? Why?
I'm not sure that, people are given the same respect outside also. That we have to ask them and see. But really speaking, people are people here also, there also. That's my, take on that. But we can see whether that is really true. We would have to ask the people there and see what is happening there.
Some people in abroad, for some USA, even though they are the lower cadre, they are respected in proper way, but not in India.
Yeah, so we might have different set of preconditionings here. Mm. They might have a different set of preconditionings there. Mm. So, depending on that, if we are going by our
Indian mentality, still we have to change.
we had a feudal system or whatever. So based on that, we might have some preconditionings.
Yeah, because we are ruled by British people for a long period.
I'm just giving an example. So, but The basic thing is we have to get past the preconditionings and look at our natural acceptance. Mm, that is the main thing that, you know, we need to do. Yeah, thank you. So we have the results of this reflection. It's saying that we generally treat people of other belief systems same as us. That's nice. So here the gross misunderstanding is that if the preconditioning of the other is matching my preconditioning, then the other is like me. But really speaking, every human being is like me. I need to look at my natural acceptance and then see. So like this, we have been differentiating, you know, on the basis of body, basis of physical facility, beliefs, and so on, from a long time. And this is all disrespect. And you ask yourself, is this naturally acceptable to you? And the obvious answer is, this is not naturally acceptable. And that is why there is so much opposition and so many movements against all of this differentiation. So we'll take one more reflection from you. I can see that differentiation is disrespect. Yes or no? Are you able to see this? That when we differentiate, it is disrespect. Yes or no? We'll take one or two more questions.
I think, okay, Dr. Guru Prasad. Dr. Abdullah Hassan Nazib.
Good afternoon,
madam.
Yeah, good afternoon.
This is Dr. Guru Prasad.
Good afternoon, madam. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Let us listen to Guru Prasad, sir.
I need your opinion about my thought, ma'am. Saw a person at the first time, we are giving respect to them. When the days goes on, slowly the respect is getting down because of so many factors, maybe because of how we are believing them and how they are reacting to us. And based on that, we are the respect level is getting degraded, I guess. So what is your opinion about that?
Although your voice faded away, but I think I got your question. We want to live with respect and we start with that, but somewhere when they behave differently, we don't treat them with the same respect. Again, we have to see, we have to keep in mind, we have to ask our natural acceptance. We have to be aware of our natural acceptance and see that, is the other person like me on this basis? Now, what we are seeing in their behavior, that is part of their competence. That is what the potential that has not been realized, like we said. So if we keep that in mind, then it can help us to see from a different perspective. And we'll come to that in the next, as we go further, we'll see what we can do about those situations.
Thank you.
So yeah, most people are able to see differentiation is disrespect. But it is not enough just to see. We also need to bring it in our living. That is the important part. So we can see this is also, an assumption that we are, not looking we are not really visualizing from our natural acceptance. But if we are aware of our natural acceptance, we can see that everybody's natural acceptance is the same. We can see that we all have the same power, the same potential, same purpose, all the same things. So in that sense, we are all similar. So we need to, give respect and to everybody. But we tend to differentiate when we have all these assumptions in us, when we are not working with our natural acceptance. So we base it on their competence. We base it on what, their behavior is like. So that's what we mentioned. That's what the previous question was about. So when we just base it on how they are behaving, then we are just working with that assumption on the basis of the competence. So we said that our purpose is the same on the basis of our natural acceptance. We all want to live with continuous happiness and prosperity. Our program is the same for this happiness and prosperity. We want to understand and live in harmony. The other also wants to do that. And our potential is also the same. Like we have natural acceptance and desires, thoughts and expectations continuously going on, the other also has the same. So our purpose, program and potential is the same. And in that sense, the other is similar to me. And we said this was the minimum content of respect. So on these three counts, we are similar. There is one difference. That difference is on the basis of competence. So when I see that the other has some differences, when I can see that I am giving respect, but the other is not behaving the right way with me, then what do I do? Then I can see this, that their competence is lacking. Even though the other is similar to me and still deserves respect from me, the competence of the other person is lacking. So when I evaluate the person's competence and my competence, then I can see our complementarity. What do we mean by that? That if the other person has more understanding, if the other person is more competent than me, is more responsible than me, then I understand. I am committed to understand from the other. But if I have more understanding, if I feel I am more responsible than the other, then I can live with responsibility with the other without getting disturbed by the behavior of the other. So the question that had been asked earlier, I guess you would have got your answer now, that even though we treat others with respect, but when they don't treat us back with respect or they don't behave the way we expect them to, but if we think that we are more understanding, if we think that we are more responsible, then we should try not to get disturbed by this behavior of the other. In fact, we should see what is the problem there. Like there is a problem of competence. So I can start looking at whether I can help the other person improve the competence. So, you know, I can try to help the other person improve their understanding. Of course, this will be after the other is assured in the relationship. That is after we have established trust. Like we mentioned, trust is the foundation value. If we don't have trust between each other, then the relationship cannot go forward. So if we are trying to work from respect, but we don't even have trust with the other, then the other person will not be open to, you know, whatever I have to try to do with them. If I'm trying to help also, the other person may not take my help willingly. So first we need to establish trust, then we need to work on our own competence, and then look at how we can help the other person, keeping in mind that the other person may have a competence that is lower than mine. But if the other person's competence is lower than mine, not that I should get disturbed by it, but rather I can see that because I have more competence, I can behave more responsibly. So instead of getting disturbed by that behavior, I can start looking at ways on how to help the other person. So now that is the complete content of respect. One part of it was that the other is similar to me. The complete part, the next part or the complete content of respect is that we are complementary to each other. So we may be different in the terms of competence. So again, if we look at this, what we looked at earlier when we discussed trust, the green part in the different columns, the different selves is the competence. The red part is the lack of competence. So we can see that the intention potential program is the same for all. Where we are different is only in this competence. This competence, because it is different, doesn't mean we need to differentiate from one another. This competence difference just means that I can feel complementary to the other. So if I feel related to the other person, if I have trust on the other person's intention, if I can see that it's just a lack of competence, then I can try to help the other person, be complementary to the other person. And that's how, you know, we can both develop further. So this takeaway from this is that feeling of complementariness. Once we have this feeling of complementariness, the other feelings will naturally follow. Of course, you know, at the level of body, at the level of physical facility, at the level of belief where we were differentiating, we can use all of these differences to express that complementarity. For example, a person who has greater physical strength, we need not differentiate in terms of respect, but rather if we have a person of greater physical strength and a person of, you know, less physical strength, we can be complementary to each other in that the person with the greater physical strength can do the heavy work, while the person who has less physical strength can do the less heavy work. Similarly, a person at a higher post can work for the development of more people who are below that post, and so on. So when you have this feeling of complementariness, then there is responsibility in the relationship. Then you think of giving, then you think of improving the other's competence. But today, you know, what is happening is differentiation, like we said, and we can see the differences between differentiation and respect on the basis of the self. So when I'm differentiating, I'm evaluating on the basis of body, on the basis of physical facility or belief, that is the preconditioning. I keep comparing with the other, I compete with the other, I differentiate, I feel like I'm different from the other, right? So I treat the maid's children a different way, I treat my child a different way, I treat a well-dressed person a different way, I treat a poorly dressed or a badly dressed person differently, and so on. But when I'm looking on the basis of the self, then I can see that our purpose on the basis of natural acceptance is the same. Our program is also the same. Our potential is also the same. So I can see that the other is similar to me. When I differentiate, we are competitors. So if my neighbor buys a car, I try to buy a bigger car. Or when I go to a, you know, higher post, then I try to go into a bigger house, and so on. We keep competing with one another. But when I see on the basis of the self, then we are complementary to each other. Then I start helping out the other person. So if I have a car, then it doesn't mean that I have to buy a bigger car. If my neighbor doesn't have a car, I can take my neighbor for a ride and, you know, do our grocery shopping together or something like that. We can be complementary to each other. When we differentiate, we make effort to accentuate this difference. We keep manipulating, we keep exploiting the other people, you know. We try to show that we are on a higher post, or we have more money, or whatever, on all of these differences. But when we understand respect on the basis of the self, then we can see we are complementary to each other. So if the other has more understanding than me, I am committed to understand from the other. But if I have more understanding, if I feel that I have more response, I am more responsible, then I can live with that responsibility with the other. So then I am committed to facilitate the understanding in the other. Of course, that is once I have assured the other in relationship and not before that. That means once the other has trust in me, then we can do that. So is there a question we can take now?
Dr. Sundar Raj? I think we invite those who have not spoken so
yes,
far.
Yes.
I am Dr. Sundar Raj, sir.
Yes, please.
Madam, I am having one question.
Mm-hmm.
Normally, the leaders are having less trust. For example, if I am the professor or HOD, my staff are respecting and having good, more trust on me. But when I become into the principal, I am in a position to implement rules. So the implementation of the rules may cause some problems to some individuals. So that misleads, and the untrust had come. Is there any solution for that?
Yeah, so what I would say is we need to be sure of our feeling within. So it's okay to make the rules for everybody. And I think it's a good idea that everybody should follow the rules, but the rules should be similar for, you know, the various people. And what is our feeling when we are making sure that those rules are followed? If our feeling is right, generally it gets conveyed to the other person.
Yes.
And they will be open to suggestions.
For example, madam,
yes,
the feeling, only that 3 months out of 1 semester, for example, 6 months, and mm-hmm. 3 months, the teachers are teaching the lesson to the students. So mm-hmm. I insist commonly that these 3 months are productive period. So mm-hmm. avoid taking leave in the for the benefit of the students. It mm-hmm. was the rule if we are giving, mm-hmm. and at that time only everybody come for leave and continuous leave and other things. And if we are rejecting something, then the trust on the superior is going down. That's what my question is.
Yeah, Kumar Bhaiya, you have any suggestion for this?
I could not get the question completely. Can you come again, sir? Just briefly.
Yes, sir. For a semester, we are having 6 months.
Ji.
Okay, out of these 6 months, study hall days and other things are going on, and we are coming only 3 months for a teacher to teach the subject to the students.
Okay.
If I implement a rule in such a way that these 3 months, at least these 3 months, faculty should not take leave, mm-hmm. So that it is a productive period. If I am stating like that, then the trust on me is going down, and every people will come down because of some reasons. I want leave, I want one. And at that time only they are taking more amount of leave. So that means they are not trusting the higher authorities, or they are not having the benefit of the students. They are not having, duty what they are doing. They are working for the benefit of the students. They forget all.
I got a question, sir. So here, with the feeling of complementariness, we can make the right kind of program. For example, there is a faculty, and during those 3 months only, some relative has expired, or some the faculty is sick, or some concern is there, right? So naturally, he or she would like to have leave. So we have to make such a program so that we can ensure mutual happiness and mutual prosperity. So by making such stringent rules, many a times we focus on one aspect. Like one aspect that we are trying to focus on is the quality of teaching or the deliverance of the content to the student. But we are not able to focus on the happiness of the faculty. So with a feeling of complementariness and being assured of the intention, program and potential, we can see how we can be complementary to each other. We just see that if you are a faculty and a rule is made where you cannot take leave, you know, then you will not feel like being in that place for long because some genuine concern is not being met.
Yeah.
At the same time, we also have to see why we are offering like our program only for 3 months in 6 months. So we have to make such a program so that everyone is able to take care of harmony at all the four levels at the same time, you know, and it can be mutually fulfilling for all. So, for example, if you are just teaching the students for 3 months and allowing them to roam free for another 3 months, then they are going to suffer. So, we can plan our schedule accordingly.
It is the university rule, isn't it, sir? Only 3 months is the productive period. And all other time are meant for something. They are having summer vacation and other things. So, these productive periods...
As I recall, sir, like in the north, I'm not sure. Maybe I'd like to learn more from you about the rule here. But I think this is more subjected to a particular norm in the university. And for that, we can discuss maybe separately. But I suggest that while making this any kind of norm, I will try to take into account the fulfillment of all. The student, the faculty, the parents of the students, the family members of the faculty, the management, their family. And we have to make such a program so that we are able to meet that goal, you know, of mutual happiness and mutual prosperity. At the same time, we are able to inculcate those kinds of skills also in the students, you know, which can be fulfilling for them in the long run. So those things can be taken care of.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, Bhaiya. Yeah.
I think the first sum up and then we can take
fresh questions. Yeah. So there are some few points for self-reflection. In your interaction with others in the family or institution over the past 6 months, list any 5 incidences of your interaction. And you can do this, you know, you can think about it and do this, take your time later. So some 5 incidences where you have interacted with others. Now check if it was the right evaluation, over evaluation, under evaluation, or otherwise evaluation. That is one part. The other part is that we discussed about differentiation today. Give one example each of the differentiation on the 3 bases and suggest a solution to each on the basis of right understanding. So we talked of differentiation on the basis of body, on the basis of physical facility, and on the basis of beliefs. So with these 3, if you can give one example each of the differentiation and suggest a solution based on right understanding. And we'll sum up now. So we said respect is right evaluation with a feeling of trust on intention. That is first. We have to have trust, then we can look at respect. Under evaluation, over evaluation, or otherwise evaluation is disrespect, and any differentiation is disrespect. So when we respect on the basis of self, we can see that the other is like me and we are complementary to each other. Our program, our potential, our purpose is all the same. The only difference is in our level of understanding, or how much of our desire, thought, and expectation has now come on the basis of our natural acceptance. That's the only difference. So when I fulfill the relationship from my side, it leads to harmony or happiness within me. So if my feeling is right, regardless of whether I have so far helped the other or not, but at least if I have the right feeling within me, it is a source of happiness for me. It leads to my harmony. And then I can think about, you know, when I am in harmony, then I can think about helping the other person, improving the other person's competence. So if I can see our mutual competence, and if the other has more understanding, seems more responsible than me, then I can learn from the other. I can understand from the other. But if I have more understanding, I am more responsible than the other, then I should live with responsibility with the other. I should not get perturbed by the other's behavior. And that should be unconditional. Meaning, if I really have more understanding, if I have more responsibility, then I will live without getting disturbed by the other person's behavior. So it will not disturb me. And then I can help to facilitate the competence of the other. I can facilitate the understanding in the other, once the other is assured in relationship. So we'll stop with there. Maybe we can take one odd question.
Aditi, I think somebody. Dr. Ramar, Dr. K. Ramar. Somebody from the panel wants to speak. Okay, Dr. Sita Lakshmi is there. She wants to say something. Yeah, Dr. Sita Lakshmi.
First of all, I want to say it's a right progression. I think you started from the self on the first 2 days, and now we are going to relationship and the other. So now connecting both your presentations, Dr. Kumar and Dr. Sharmila, I have a doubt now. Now, in the first instance, Dr. Kumar was talking about how the self and the body, and then which end of the spectrum we are in, whether we are at the end of consciousness of the self or at the bodily or the physical vehicle. Now, Dr. Sharmila today was talking about the interaction, trust, and complementariness. Mm-hmm. Now, my question is this. So, when we are differentiating based on basic humanitarian things, that is bad, which we should not differentiate. But if there are fundamental differences in human beings in terms of which end of the spectrum they are, assuming that their basic needs are all satisfied, the physical, someone may be at the level of the evolution of the self and consciousness. Another person may be actually accelerating their physical or the bodily things. Now, in the morning, someone was talking about how even in a family, it's difficult. And now an official was telling about how it is difficult in an institution. So what happens is that, how can we find some way to be complementariness if fundamentally every person is at different ends of the spectrum? So I know that some of these questions are not answerable, but I just want to, it's a genuine.
No, ma'am, they are very much answerable. Didi, can you move to that slide where we have that bar chart showing the competence and the intention? So what you mentioned, so people have different level of understanding. So maybe you are here where it is mentioned as me. And there is another person who is having a lack of competence more than what you have. But there may be another person who is having a higher level of competence, right? So there's a complete lot of variation in the organization, in the family, in the society. This is something that we can see. So for this, first of all, I have to understand what competence is, right? So competence is right understanding. So there's a difference in the level of understanding that one has attained, isn't it? But I am able to see very clearly for myself that intention-wise, all of us are same. All of us wants to have complete right understanding so that we are able to live with happiness in continuity. And all of us are endowed with the potential of desire, thought, expectation, and also the potential to self-explore, verify, and a natural acceptance is there. And we are also able to see that the program to be competent is only this, self-exploration, not by any dogma or belief or any prescription. So when I'm able to see this, I'm able to evaluate others' competence. And with this assurance on these three grounds, intention, program, and potential, I'm able to make a program whether I can be complementary to the other. So this is something to be done. So yesterday when we were saying, so a common preconditioning is to assume oneself to be the same as body, right? So there we started by understanding the self and the body distinctly, right? And we saw that unless you understand this, you are not able to make a right program for happiness or prosperity or even relationship. And today when we started exploring relationship, we said that ultimately the relation exists between self and self. And this is something that we have got to see, right? Unless we see this clearly, we misunderstand relationships. And there are so much of differentiation and other things take place, right? So once we are able to see this for ourselves, we are able to see this for the other also. So when I interact with other person, I am always aware with the right understanding that yes, there is a variation of competence, but all of us can be competent because all of us have the same potential, but all of us will become competent only when we go through that program. So if I am going through that program, I will be able to see how much growth in competence is there in me with what kind of effort. And then I'm able to appreciate the effort of the other also. Unless I'm able to work on my competence, I cannot appreciate the effort made by the other also, right?
I don't mean competence at all, sir. Competence is actually something which is like a person can have limitation. I'm talking more about the intention of a person, not the competence at all.
Okay. I hope you are there, ma'am, when we are talking about the intention and program and potential. Didi, can we move to the previous slide? Even more earlier than this? Yeah. So, intention-wise, could you see that intention-wise you are all the same?
No, sir. That's what in yesterday's presentation, there was this discussion of the self and the consciousness and the body. So, that spectrum will be different. Everyone would be at a different end of the spectrum.
Wait, ma'am. When you are bringing this word spectrum, you are trying to relate this to the level of competence, isn't it? But
no,
everybody...
No.
So, what do you mean by competence?
At the level of the self, we are all similar, right?
Yeah. So I think when you are using the word spectrum, what are you trying to relate it to the natural acceptance or the competence?
Not with a competence.
Ma'am, what do you mean by competence? What do you mean by competence?
Competence means efficiency with which we do these transactions in
No, no. We are not referring to this. We are saying that competence is the level of understanding. It is a skill that you are mentioning.
Like, okay, so, so
yeah.
Yes, I understand that. But the thing is that from the self, when you move to the other, that competence or that understanding, even everyone would be at different levels of, even let's say I'm self-aware that I'm at this end of the spectrum. I'm self-aware that I'm that end of the spectrum, even with that understanding or the right understanding. So now people's, where they are placed in that spectrum, there will be conflict in that between
people. No. There will be complementarity. If you look at this slide in front of you, ma'am.
Okay.
Aditi, there is a bottom line here. Can you just
okay. let it be?